Welcome to all of us here in Washington and around the world for this unique gathering. I'm Andrea Mitchell from NBC News, and so honored to be here today with all of our colleagues here at the State Department. We're gathered to mark the 60th anniversary of the Convention of the Status of Refugees. To honor the spirit behind the convention, we are paying tribute to six individuals who stepped forward at great personal risk to rescue persons in imminent danger of death or gross human rights violations. And today we will hear their unique stories, and we'll be joined by the honorees or their families here and at events hosted by our embassies in Senegal, Rwanda, and Bosnia and Herzegovina. I can think of no better person to recognize the courage of these individuals than the Secretary of State, who will be joining us and who's involved in some very important conversations, as we know, with all of the events that are happening around the world, and has a White House meeting as we speak. But as we anticipate her arrival, we also want to first notice that there are going to be photographs of the honorees currently on display around the Ben Franklin Rooms, and after today's events, those framed photos will be on permanent display in the State Department Bureau of Population, Refugees, and Migration. There are more than 15 million refugees in the world today, as current events in Libya and Cote d'Ivoire and elsewhere make painfully clear. New refugees are forced to flee their homes somewhere in the world virtually every day. Caring for these refugees in their hour of need is a collective international responsibility that the United States takes very seriously. Now I have the honor of introducing the host of today's event and the State Department steward of the U.S. government's refugee assistance and resettlement programs, Eric Schwartz, Assistant Secretary for Population, Refugees, and Migration. Secretary Schwartz.
Thank you, Andrea, and thank you all for joining us for this celebration of the 60th anniversary of the Refugee Convention. I speak with a keen awareness that my remarks may be interrupted by the arrival of the Secretary of State, and when that happens, I will turn the podium back to Andrea. But since we don't know just when the Secretary will arrive, I will continue. The convention reflects the deep commitment of the Obama administration, of the Department of State, to the principles of humanitarianism. And what an honor and what a pleasure for me to work for Secretary of State Clinton, who herself is such a tireless champion of the rights of the world's most vulnerable people. I'm very grateful to be here today with our honorees, with their families, in person and via video link. Secretary Clinton will be speaking about these remarkable individuals when she joins us in a few minutes, but let me offer a quick word of thanks to many others in our bureau, in the department, in our partner organizations who helped make this event possible, and of course, our ambassadors in Dakar, in Kigali, and Sarajevo. And I'd like to take a moment, if I may, to talk about how this event took shape and what it means not only to the Bureau of Population, Refugees, and Migration, but also to the government. As we began planning our commemorations of the 60th anniversary of the Refugee Convention, we reflected on the story of the SS St. Louis and thought that a photographic commemoration of the experience of that unfortunate ship and its doomed passengers ought to be in the department and in our bureau as a critical symbol and as a reminder to us all. As many of you know, the St. Louis was a ship carrying 930 Jewish refugees from Germany in 1939. And the ship's passengers, unable to find refuge in Cuba, in the United States, or in Canada, or elsewhere, were forced to return to Europe, where estimates are that more than 250 of them eventually perished in the Holocaust. We thought that a photographic commemoration of the St. Louis would serve as a reminder to us all of the critical importance of humanitarianism and the costs of the failure to assist those who are in need. But on reflection, we thought that this was inadequate, that while we need to confront past failure, we must also recognize the most noble and the most heroic impulses behind the Refugee Convention and honor those whose actions have embodied that very spirit. PRM protection experts, PRM is the acronym for our bureau, PRM protection experts worked with the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum, the Yale University Genocide Studies Project, the Proof Project, and U.S. embassies and others to identify six heroes, honorees, recognizing that there are certainly many more individuals who have acted heroically in times of conflict. To be sure, all those who seek to realize these protection principles day in and day out have not been tested the way our honorees have been tested. But as we commemorate the Refugee Convention, who better? Who better for us to recognize than heroes? Ordinary people acting in extraordinary ways to realize this spirit of refuge and protection. Those who have demonstrated first great courage, a willingness to persevere in pursuit of a higher objective despite serious risk, danger, or other personal sacrifice. Second, those who have acted with integrity, with consistency of character, with fidelity and commitment to maintaining core principles that guide their actions. And finally, a commitment to humanitarianism, a basic belief that every individual is fundamentally deserving of respect, of dignity, and of welfare. A hero, of course, is made when someone is tested in extraordinary circumstances and demonstrates each and every one of these three qualities: courage, integrity, and humanitarianism. But even those of us who are not so dramatically tested can seek to vindicate each of these qualities in our lives every day. We'll hear from the Secretary about heroes from Bosnia and Rwanda, but let me take the opportunity to talk about two others whom we recognize and who will be part of our photo exhibit, which is in the rooms to my right. Let me begin with the story of a woman who was born just 80 miles from here. Born a slave on a plantation in eastern Maryland, every American schoolchild knows the name she took after she escaped to Philadelphia and began working for the Underground Railroad, Harriet Tubman. She bore the physical and spiritual scars of her ordeal, as do many modern refugees. She had whip scars on her back and neck, and the searing memory of having witnessed her two older sisters being sold off and being dragged away. Yet once she made it to freedom, she sneaked back into the slave South, not once, but more than a dozen times. She rescued a sister, four brothers, and then her parents. She told her abolitionist friends that as soon as she got her family out, she would stop her dangerous missions. But, of course, she didn't. And when the Civil War began, she once again went behind Confederate lines, helping run raids on plantations that freed hundreds of slaves. We honor Harriet Tubman today not only for her extraordinary heroism in fighting against the evils of slavery in her own time, but also because her legacy lives on here in the United States and around the world. And of course, her inclusion reminds us that modern slavery continues to plague us. We also honor today Raoul Wallenberg, credited with rescuing tens of thousands of Hungarian Jews during the Holocaust through his creative efforts as a Swedish diplomat in Nazi-occupied Budapest in 1944. He forged thousands of Swedish passports, and then he distributed them to Hungarian Jews facing deportation. He bribed and blackmailed Nazi officials to save Jewish lives. He gave food and medicine to Jews as they were marched to their deaths, and he himself is believed to have died in a Soviet gulag. And of course, after the horrors of the Holocaust and the massive dislocation resulting from the Second World War, the international community came together to adopt the Refugee Convention, which we commemorate today. The six individuals we honor embody the principles of the Refugee Convention at its most fundamental level. They demonstrated heroism, enormous courage, integrity, and humanitarianism in the service of others. We cannot all be heroes, but the stories of these remarkable individuals can inspire each of us in government, in the non-governmental community, and in civil society to persevere in pursuit of this higher purpose, whether it is by defending our own neighbors, going above and beyond the call of duty to keep peace and help in distant countries in conflict, bearing witness to abuses, or ensuring our government and our non-governmental organizations are leading the efforts to address human sufferings, and that we are prepared to provide the resources, the funds, to do that job effectively. We all understand that ultimately humanitarian crises require political solutions. At the same time, humanitarian crises and human suffering demand immediate responses. They can help to promote stability and peace in fragile countries and make the United States safer and more prosperous. But they also reflect our highest ideals and our highest aspirations. The United States has led the world in the provision of overseas support for humanitarian protection and assistance, and we've provided asylum and refugee resettlement for millions over the past three decades and longer. But there is still so much more to do. And the model, the lesson, the inspiration provided by those whom we honor today will only help us to sustain and strengthen these efforts. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Secretary Schwartz. Thank you for reminding us the roots of why we are here. And the 60 years of suffering that has been alleviated, really, by the work of people such as the people whom you honor, whom we honor today. Thank you for dedication, your dedication to these issues, the work that you do here in the Bureau of Refugees and Migration. It's truly inspiring and such a vital part of the U.S. foreign policy. And now we have the honor of going to the U.S. Embassy in Dakar, Senegal, where we will have the chance to hear from Ambassador Marsha Bernicot, who is with the family of Captain Mbaye Jean. And nice to speak with you, Ambassador, even by satellite.
Ambassador Bernicot. Convention. I am very proud to speak to you today from Senegal, the home of one of today's honorees, the late Captain Mbaye Jean. You are going to hear soon about the details of his acts of heroism and bravery. Senegal is no stranger to refugee flows resulting from instability elsewhere in West Africa. In each instance, the government of Senegal has worked conscientiously to welcome and then resettle or repatriate these refugees. Within Senegal, the government has been able to return to their land a number of people displaced by the fighting in the Casamance, in part thanks to more than $2.4 million given by the U.S. to clear mines from over 1.7 million square meters of land, as well as to conduct other risk reduction activities. We at the U.S. Mission are also proud of the work we have done over the last years alongside the government of Senegal in the Casamance to promote peace and reconciliation. Captain Mbaye Jean's exceptional actions are part of the tapestry that is Senegal, a country whose heroes have for many years been deployed in peacekeeping missions around the world to protect refugees and others whose lives are threatened by conflict. Today, Senegalese serve as peacekeepers in Darfur, Cote d'Ivoire, the Democratic Republic of Congo, and Haiti. And in August 2010, UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon appointed Senegal's Lieutenant General Babacar Gaye as his military advisor for peacekeeping operations. President Abdoulaye Wade of Senegal, widely respected for his role in conflict resolution on the continent, is yet another example of this strong tradition. Captain Mbaye Diagne's personifies Senegal's commitment to peace and humanitarian service. His actions and those of other heroes being honored today prove that one person can make a difference. His selfless decision to save lives in a foreign country was courageous, but no surprise to those of us who know the Senegalese, their long-standing history as a peaceful nation, and their thoroughly professional military, of which he was a part. Captain Diagne's legacy lives most intensely in the lives of the people he saved and in the example he set for all of us. We are proud that Captain Diagne is being recognized among today's honorees. And now, I have the honor of presenting a certificate to Captain Diagne's widow and mother to commemorate his bravery and selflessness in saving hundreds of lives and in doing so, ultimately giving his own. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Ambassador, and we also want to acknowledge the presence here of Senegal's Ambassador to the United States, Ambassador Diagne, who is with us here. So thank you very much
for being with us, Madam Ambassador.
Now I have the honor of introducing the Deputy High Commissioner for Refugees, Alexander Alenikov. As Deputy, Mr. Alenikov helps UNHCR lead and coordinate international action to protect refugees and resolve refugee problems worldwide. Mr. Alenikov.
Thank you very much. I'm delighted to be here today to take part in the commemoration of the 60th anniversary of the Refugee Convention and to pay tribute to the persons of courage we recognize today. The convention, of course, defines the very foundation of UNHCR's work, but it is work shared with many, many partners around the world, and no relationship has been more important to UNHCR over the past 60 years than our partnership with the United States and with the Department of State. The Department of State was literally present at the creation of the Refugee Convention, playing an important role in the drafting of the convention, and for 60 years has helped to promote its values and its implementation around the world. And I would like to particularly recognize our partnership with the Bureau of Population, Refugees, and Migration, now under the able leadership of Eric Schwartz, both for PRM's generous financial support to UNHCR, but equally important for their strong advocacy on behalf of refugees, internally displaced people, and stateless people around the world. Now, everyone in this room recognizes the high politics involved in humanitarian assistance in North Africa, Cote d'Ivoire. Events are happening that invoke global powers, global processes, global interests. But we also all recognize that humanitarian assistance is actually delivered at the micro, at the granular, at the individual, at the face-to-face level, and also under extremely difficult circumstances quite often. We will hear a number of those stories today, but let me tell you a few from our story in UNHCR. Last week, a UNHCR office in western Cote d'Ivoire was broken into, ransacked, vehicles, computers were stolen, our work was stopped. Last month, the UNHCR staff member lost his life, killed by a stray bullet in fighting in South Sudan among conflicting parties. And I mentioned also our Washington representative, Vincent Cochetel, who was sitting in the front row with us today, who was kidnapped and held captive for more than a year while serving in Chechnya a number of years ago. So we know the dangers, and it is right and wonderful today that we take a few minutes to recognize these people of courage. Now, my guess is that many of the people we recognize and honor today might well say, I signed up for this job. I was just carrying out the mission. I did what others would have done. But I think that would not really be correct. To undertake the work that they did in the first place in the face of known danger and to carry it out with success, ultimately at the cost of their lives for some, is a mark of tremendous courage. And equally important, it seems to me, it's a role model for others to emulate as we seek to interest others in our work and the next generation of humanitarians. The Refugee Convention embodies a very simple principle. No one should be returned to a situation in which they're likely to face persecution. So simple to say, so hard to make real. And today we salute those who, through their personal courage, work to make that principle real for some of the most vulnerable people on this planet. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lanikoff, for making it very real indeed. And as we speak, of course, events continue to unfold in Cote d'Ivoire with your people right on the front lines there. And the accomplishment, the accomplishment of UNHCR over the last 50 years of offering a lifeline to displaced people truly does demonstrate the highest standards to which the international community aspires. Now we will be traveling to Rwanda to speak with Ambassador Stuart Symington. Ambassador Symington?
Symington?
To you.
To you.
Andrea, thank you very much. And thanks to all of you there who have helped to include Rwanda in your commemoration of those heroes who are the essential bridge between places of danger and places of refuge. Without you, including the lady that I am privileged to sit next to and her son, there would be no refugees. A few years ago in Rwanda, every Rwandan was faced with a choice. And when she had a chance to make that choice, our honored guest, Dusabimana, made the only choice that she thought she could, consistent with her faith. I hope later the Secretary will give you more details, but let me just point out that she made that choice at the risk of her son, who's sitting to my right, and other members of her family. And when I asked her why she made it, she said, because those whom I protected were my neighbors. They were human beings. When I asked her how she could make that choice, she said, I did not do it with my own strength, but with the strength of my faith and the strength of my God. When I asked her what she saw in the future of Rwanda, she said a word that I have often heard since I arrived here. Amahoro, peace. And she also said a word that I have increasingly heard here, so that we could live together in prosperity. Tomorrow, Rwanda begins the 17th commemoration of 100 days of genocide that ripped that country apart in ways that the world will, I hope, always remember. But I think it's essential today, with me sitting here next to you, and behind us with many other Rwandans who, like you, have made a difference and have been heroes, I think it's essential to remember this. Rwanda's story is not Rwanda's alone. It's the story of every nation on earth and every person. Eric, when you mentioned that the name of the ship that was turned back at every port was St. Louis, it reminded me of the city of my roots. But when you mentioned the idea of people finding refuge in a boat, it reminded me of that essential instrument that this lady represented, linking danger and linking safety, and the spirit that motivated her, which was simply brotherhood. As Rwanda commemorates tomorrow the 17th anniversary of the genocide, it's important to remember not only that the target of the genocide in Rwanda were those whose fathers were Tutsis, but that the instruments of Rwandan heroism were often those whose fathers were Hutus. And those heroes who today, when you ask them, as I did our honored guest, say simply, "We are Rwandans," are repeating a theme that is a subset of a larger universal one, which is, we are all members of the family of man. Ultimately, the goal of our refugee convention is, as we just heard, to make it so that people would not be forced to return to places where they are persecuted. But the goal of ourselves is to go much further. It is to take places in the world where there is persecution and do away with it. It is to take places where there is no security and find and provide peace. And it is to make it possible for people to be prosperous in places that are today pools of uncertainty and despair. As we look ahead, it's important to think of some of the things that America has helped Rwandans to do in true partnership, working with women entrepreneurs, working with children who were the orphans of the genocide, working with youth to make sure that when they talk, they have a chance to share the messages of their own nation and of our common humanity. But I think it's even more important as we think about how you dry up those pools of despair, both here and in the neighborhood, and replace them with places to which, like millions of Rwandans, people can come home because they no longer live in fear. I think it's also important to think that behind me in this room are many Rwandans who have, by their work and their efforts together, literally woven together again the fabric of Rwanda. Today, when I asked what Dusabimana thought of as her future, she said, "We've gone far, and we have far to go together." I think that describes the challenge for us, and I want to applaud not just those who work with refugees to make sure that they reach safety, and those who work to make sure that refugees are treated fairly once they arrive there, but to all those hundreds of thousands of Rwandans and others around the world, fellow peacekeepers like the Senegalese. Rwanda itself has the largest contingent in the Sudan today, and the commander, and just sent a bunch of women and men as UN police peacekeepers to Haiti. But not only to salute those who protect people in their hours of need, but also to recognize those who weave together the future again, so that in the end, refugees can come home. I say this with particular pride and interest as we think about what unites the United States and Rwanda. If you talk to Americans, they will often say the motto of our country is out of many, one. If you talk to Rwandans, they will often say, we were divided and now we are united. But if you look in the mirror and you see a fellow member of this single family of man, the greatest truth is we were one, we were divided, and we shall be one again, thanks to heroes like this lady whom I'm honored to sit beside. And now, on behalf of the secretary, I will extend this certificate, which is some small remembrance of her heroism and its significance.
with your sentence. Thank you, Andrea, very much.
Thank you, Ambassador Symington. Thank you, and we honor, along with you, Ms. Dusabamina, and all of your colleagues there in Rwanda.
And just a note as a journalist, there are many who talk about Rwanda as the example that has become the paradigm for why we need to be so conscious of the events happening around the world today, the humanitarian needs. As a journalist, we were so late to recognize the importance of shedding our light on what was happening in Rwanda. And it was only, frankly, after some very brave colleagues from British journalism, British television, went there that we in America responded. So there are many lessons to be learned for those in public policy, for those in journalism, for those around the world in civil society, about not waiting too long when we see these events unfolding. But for this to be seen internationally, it has to have the attention of the world. And for that, we also in journalism play, I think, a critical role when we are doing our jobs correctly. I also want to acknowledge Rwanda's ambassador to the United States, Ambassador Kimonyo, has joined us here today. Thank you so much, Mr. Ambassador. And as we all know, the world has known many great tragedies, but the story that Ambassador Symington tells us about today of peace and reconciliation throughout the scene of such horror at least is an encouragement for all of us to believe that healing, forgiveness, reconciliation is possible no matter how tragic and dreadful and horrific the circumstances. Now I have the great pleasure of introducing the Undersecretary for Democracy and Global Affairs, Maria Otero.
Thank you, Andrea, for that introduction. It is a pleasure to be here with you today, celebrating the spirit of the Refugee Convention, honoring these incredible individuals, hearing their stories from Rwanda, from Senegal, and being inspired by their work. Before we hear from and speak with the final honoree from Sarajevo, I want to share a few thoughts with you on the United States' commitment to providing refugee assistance to all of those in need. The Refugee Convention was signed six decades ago, but it's hardly a document of another era. It hasn't gathered dust in the years since the resounding statement that it made on refugees and on their rights. Indeed, in every year since then, the United States has renewed its commitment to the support of the Convention's high purpose. The United States seeks to respond to calls for help from the world over. We provide refuge for those that are fleeing war, for those that are fleeing famine or oppression. We pursue disaster risk reduction, like in Nepal, where the expectation of an earthquake is in the not-so-distant future, where we can help lessen the impact of tragedies that force people from their own homes. We work to prevent genocides and massacres. We have learned from the lesson in Rwanda, and we are doing that now in Libya. And we work towards conflict resolution and genuine reconciliation to help heal fragile nations and their people. In all of this work, we know that human security underpins national security and global stability. We understand that our success is contingent on the safety and the security of individuals. Those who have done no harm, citizens who have no voice, our brothers and sisters whose hearts beat just like ours, even though they live in very dire circumstances. The United States will continue to respond to those in need in these emergencies. Just recently, We provided $47 million so far to the humanitarian organizations that are operating in Tunisia, in Egypt, and in parts of Libya. And we will continue to commit more resources in the coming months as events develop in this part of the world. In West Africa, Nigeria was one of the largest refugee-producing nations in the continent. Today, it has become a country of asylum. Political instability in Côte d'Ivoire has pushed more than 100,000 new refugees from that country into Liberia. And the United States is providing assistance to UNHCR and to others that are providing the critical support that is needed there. But this is not really about the United States. Our support reinforces the compelling portrait that we have in Africa, in which strong spirit of ordinary Liberians, Tunisians, Egyptians, Rwandans, Senegalese, as we have heard, is really painted by the incredible hospitality that they provide to their neighbors, to their family, but to strangers alike in these moments of crisis. It's through our consistent and deep engagement that the United States has sought to be instrumental, and we believe has been instrumental, in developing the organizational system of humanitarian response and strengthening the organizations that comprise this system. We learned today from Rwanda and from Senegal, and we'll hear more from our other honoree, that the United States is committed to helping communities recover from war and recover from genocide. Together with the local stakeholders, with those that are looking to rebuild the foundations of their own countries, we want to be able to stand with them and to stand also the test of time and the test of conflict. In South Sudan, for example, we've supported the return of over 330,000 Sudanese refugees since the peace agreement was signed in 2005. The United States is also working throughout many of the cornerstones of the African continent, where we see that crisis of one way or another has displaced people, and where we are seeking also to facilitate the promotion of peace and reconciliation, and to try to avert wide-scale violence wherever possible. As many of you know, we are also developing a national plan of action on UN Resolution 1325 on women, peace, and security to better ensure that women are full participants in the peacemaking and in the peace building and in the integrating of their communities, because we know that this is a role that they play. We know that they help bring about sustainable peace, and that they can help address some of the priorities that the countries need. We also know that violence against women, particularly when it's used as a weapon of armed conflict, is an obstacle to national and international peace and to security in each country. And we also know the political stability and economic growth have to go hand in hand. The legacy of the three women that we are honoring today exemplify the courage, the leadership, the inspiration nature that these women provide us with. And we see that through their work, they are working on those critical issues of peace, of security, and they're mobilizing their communities. And under extraordinary circumstances, they are saving lives. Our commitment to this work not only reflects a moral imperative, but it also helps to promote peace and security when despair and desperation threaten stability and threaten even our own national interests. The modest resources that we spend on saving lives and alleviating suffering are a sound investment in a peaceful and prosperous world for all. Like many of you today, I am inspired by the women that we are honoring. And I want to thank everyone here, also for all the work that you do, for all your commitment and all your interest and ability to be able to address these issues yourself, because you are also embodying the Refugee Convention in so many different ways. Thank you. And let me take this opportunity, as I am here, what we would like to do is honor Larry Hollingworth from the United Kingdom for all of the important work that he has done. And so we'd like to present this certificate to Larry in order to be able to acknowledge and recognize your work. And let me take a minute and read what the certificate says. It says, for leading the efforts of the Office of the UN High Commission of Refugees to ensure humanitarian access to communities under siege during the war in Bosnia, undertaking personal risk above and beyond what was mandated by his position in order to save lives and alleviate suffering, and demonstrating true heroism as he bore witness to the flight and to the plight of besieged community, signed by Hillary Rodham Clinton.
And our congratulations to Mr. Hollingworth for all that he did. And thank you, Undersecretary Otero. You seem to travel almost as much as Secretary Clinton, so there is a certain track record of women at the State Department who are endlessly on the road doing very important work. And now I'd like to take all of us to our final embassy today, where we will meet Ambassador Rick Moon and have the chance to hear about the embassy's support for peace and reconciliation there for the initiatives in Bosnia and Herzegovina. And thank you to everyone at that embassy for joining us today. Ambassador Moon, please tell us about the embassy's very important work.
Ambassador? Well, thank you very much, Andrea. We are here in Sarajevo, very pleased to be participating in this very important ceremony today. And let me first introduce a woman, a true hero, an extraordinary person, Ms. Mina Jahic, who's here with us, and introduce as well the man who is here only because of Mrs. Jahic's courage, Mr. Farid Spahic. We also have in the room today a number of other truly extraordinary human beings, people who, like Mina, risk their own lives to help those in danger. We also have representatives from organizations that continue the worthy work of building peace in Bosnia and Herzegovina. Despite its complicated history, Bosnia and Herzegovina's citizens have a long tradition of multi-ethnic coexistence and of helping neighbors, friends, and even strangers who do not share their religion or ethnicity. Bosnians of all faiths have demonstrated this kind of moral courage even in the most dire circumstances. 40 Bosnian citizens are listed as righteous among nations for their brave acts during World War II, including the family members, some family members who are here with us today. At times, those who saved during World War II later became saviors themselves by helping their former rescuers or their families escape to safety during the 1990s. Now more than ever, Bosnia and Herzegovina needs people like Mina and the others who are here with me today. The path for those who wish to return to their homes is not always easy. Children all too often grow up hearing angry rhetoric that prioritizes ethnic ties over tolerance, and even over economic development and political progress. Yet those present today give us reason to be optimistic. our colleagues from the Interreligious Council use their face as bridges of tolerance. NGOs, international organizations, and government agencies are working to solidify the peace and use the country's diverse ethnic heritage to make it stronger. We at the American Embassy are very proud to be part of that effort. We are currently contributing over $1 million to help families in Rogatica, Foča, and Visegrad leave collective refugee centers and return to their pre-war homes. USAID is working with Catholic Relief Services on a project called Choosing Peace Together, which unites members of victims' associations of all ethnicities through training on communication, trauma, healing, and forgiveness. And even as we try to heal the wounds of the past, we're also looking toward the future. Currently, 18 Bosnian students from different ethnic backgrounds are in Oregon, learning about tolerance and civil society through the embassy's youth leadership program. This program started here 12 years ago, and each year students who grow up in communities in which their inter-ethnic communication is rare return home with new friends of other faith and a new sense of what it means to be Bosnian. Finally, the embassy is especially proud to participate in Rescue and Refuge because the photographs that are being unveiled today will be coming to Bosnia and Herzegovina this summer as part of a project we're calling Picturing Moral Courage. In that way, we can share the message of those heroic individuals with a new audience and a new generation. Mina Jahic's story is important not only because she put her own life at risk, but because she successfully called on her community to find their courage and empathy, those essential values that are so easily sacrificed when people are themselves in danger. This ability to inspire others and the courage to listen when someone like Mina calls on us are the qualities that create heroes. And so it is with great pleasure that I am able to present on the behalf of the Secretary, a certificate to Ms. Mina Jahic for providing refuge to a person in grave danger during the war in Bosnia-Herzegovina and inspiring her community to join her efforts, demonstrating true heroism and inspiring a legacy of selflessness and courage. Thank you, Ms. Jahic.
Velika čast koju ne mogu nikad zaboraviti. Ovo najbolje indicije energista na svijetu.
Oh, thank you very much.
Hvala svima.
We're so pleased to be with you today.
Kad sam ovo doživjela. I danas opet i uvijek i vas da bi tako isto učinila. Spasila bi život ko bi mogla, god mogla. Nikad neću odustati od toga. Volim spasiti, spašavam.
Thank you very much for those words from your heart. And we all owe a great debt of gratitude to you.
Thank you all, Ambassador Moon and all of your colleagues and the heroes there at your side. While we wait for Secretary Clinton, who has been involved with a conference call with the White House this morning, and we know how many issues are on her plate, I wanted to bring back Eric Schwartz, Undersecretary Schwartz, to talk about the larger mission of your bureau.
Thank you, Andrea. The Secretary is determined to come. And that explains why these are not closing remarks. But there are a few matters that absolutely would detain her, and she's involved in one right now. But she has asked that you stay. So if you must go, we won't force you to stay. But we have received a request that she would very much like to get up here, and is determined to do so. So she's asked me to carry on. And with your permission, I'll do that. And I think the easiest way, and I think the most productive way, to carry on is I always love to field questions about the work that we do in not only the Bureau of Population, Refugees, and Migration, but in our entire humanitarian assistance efforts. We partner with our colleagues at the Bureau for Democracy, Conflict, and Humanitarian Assistance at the U.S. Agency for International Development, with the Department of Defense. So the humanitarian enterprise on the part of the U.S. government is very much collective engagement. So with that, let me just throw out let me throw it out to all of you. If you have any questions or comments that you'd like to offer, and I'd be happy to, on the record, give you my most honest and transparent responses. Yes, there she is, Ann Richards.
Something has changed in the United States that people don't appreciate these things anymore, or have you found that there are allies for supporting these important programs on Capitol Hill?
I think the battle isn't over yet, and I think that there are there is an important reservoir of support for the humanitarian mission within the United States and within our body politic. Most Americans, I believe, assume when there's a crisis, just assume, most Americans outside of the Beltway, outside of Washington, D.C., assume that when there's a crisis anywhere in the world, the United States is in the lead in alleviating human suffering around the world. And their assumption is correct, because we are. But that's because of the continued very strong support for this mission that we've had on both sides of the political aisle in the Congress over the years. And I believe that the proposals to seriously cut humanitarian assistance aren't really directed at humanitarian assistance. I think they're part of the larger debate about the budget. And so it's my hope and my expectation that as this process continues to evolve, and it's evolving on an hour by our basis, there will be a recognition of the critical importance of sustaining this support. This is the dog that doesn't bark. Our support for over a million refugees, Afghan refugees in Pakistan, has helped that government, the government of Pakistan, sustain policies and practice of tolerance to this community over the years. There is an alternative to the relatively stable situation in Pakistan that has accompanied the presence of over a million refugees over all these years. Our assistance through UNHCR and other partners has played a role in ensuring that that issue is not on the front page of the newspapers. Several million African refugees have returned peacefully to their homes over the past decade. There is an alternative to that story of peaceful return of refugee populations with the support, the strong support of the United States through UNHCR and other organizations. And the alternative is inevitably more damaging to human beings, more costly to the government of the United States, and moves us further away from the ideals to which we aspire. And I think there's an understanding of that within our body politic. And I'm quite confident, very hopeful, confident, that this support will endure. Any other questions? Yes. The question, well, but before I talk about how the proposed budget requests will affect our programs, let me just say a word about words have already been spoken, and when the Secretary arrives, more words will be spoken about the qualities of heroism in our honorees today. But let me talk a little bit about the public service dedication of our missions and our ambassadors in the countries that are linked to us today. We've heard our ambassadors talk about the commitment to promoting tolerance, promoting transparency, good government, all the things that avoid crises. And I think, in this time of talk about government shutdowns, I think it's pretty important for us to recognize the critical contributions of each of these missions and other missions around the world for the tireless and dedicated service of U.S. officials operating overseas in often challenging environments. Now, let me respond to your question. I don't like to talk about that because I don't anticipate the cuts of the magnitude that would cause us to make critical decisions about what has to go. But right now, we have embarked on some important initiatives that are not emergency initiatives, but are critically important. They're the important versus the urgent. For example, a number of our programs on strategic protection priorities relating to helping women victims of violence come from additional funds that we've received from the Congress in recent years. Programs like that, I think, would be at risk of being diminished. And that would be very unfortunate. In principle, what you would inevitably do when you have these sorts of cuts is you would have to find yourself responding increasingly to unforeseen, quick-onset emergencies so that the critically important work of sustaining your efforts in protracted situations, like the ones I mentioned, Afghanistan, Africa, though that work would be at risk. Because if Libya arises, if Cote d'Ivoire arises, you have no alternative but to respond. And if you don't have emergency resources that are dedicated to emergencies, then you look elsewhere. And so that is what we're very much afraid of. Yes. Eric.
We still have a large number of Perry Karadagi with Kurdish Human Rights Watch. We still have a lot of Iraqi refugees outside of Iraq. We also have a lot of Iraqi internally displaced persons. We also have a lot of issues concerning women at risk and trafficking of women inside Iraq to neighboring countries, Syria. We have talked about this before. I know you are very concerned. I know you have done a lot of tremendous work with all the governments of the neighboring countries to make sure that that doesn't happen and that refugee women, vulnerable refugee women, are protected. I just want to hear your perspective and your latest achievements because I know you have been a champion for this issue.
Well, I was in Iraq last year, and I will be traveling to Iraq again over the next several months. As President Obama indicated before he was elected and since, we feel a deep and profound commitment to address the humanitarian conditions and circumstances of Iraqis and Iraqi refugees. As we've said many times today, ultimately the best hope and expectation for refugee return and peace and stability is the continued promotion of the process of democratic consolidation and social and economic development within Iraq. So that, of course, is a major priority for our government. Nonetheless, that doesn't mean we walk away from the humanitarian challenge. We are by far the largest contributor to humanitarian assistance to Iraq, on the order this year, or last year, on the order of about $300 million. And that assistance goes to Iraqi refugees who are in Syria, of which there are many, Iraqi refugees who are in Jordan, elsewhere in the region, as well as to promote the process of return within Iraq when that is feasible, assistance to Iraqis who are in Iraq. But all the assistance in the world by itself is not adequate. It has to coexist, and it does, with a very active and vigorous policy dialogue that we have with the government of Iraq. So the issues that you've raised, protecting victims of violence, dealing with conditions of vulnerability, those are all critically important, and they are part of our active dialogue and discussion with the government of Iraq, and they will continue to be. I hope that answers your question. I'm sure we will have more conversations about this in the weeks and months to come. Another question. I feel the Secretary's arrival is maybe impending.
I was just going to say on that, if I can
please
jump in and tap into your expertise.
Absolutely.
When we talk about the budget, and right now Ambassador Rice is facing questions on the Hill as we speak about our budget for the UN's work on this in this regard, we have correspondents in Iraq and Afghanistan, and if the policy of the United States is to transform these into civilian efforts, the State Department needs to be funded. And that is an argument that I think we will not hear the Secretary disagree with. So, Eric Schwartz. As you can tell, we have been inspired here by the heroism of the people whom we have honored and by the service of people like Assistant Secretary Eric Schwartz and all of his colleagues. But I can think of no better person to recognize the courageous actions, the legacy of our honorees, than the Secretary of State, the Honorable Hillary Clinton, someone who has been a staunch defender of human rights, an advocate for the world's most marginalized, throughout her life, even starting in her college days from her valedictorian address at Wellesley. And we have seen her in all the decades since being the most active advocate for those most in need. Secretary of State Clinton.
Oh, thank you all. Thank you and good morning, and I apologize to all of you who are here with us in the State Department in the Ben Franklin Room, and everyone who has joined us from the embassies that are represented on the screen. There's a lot going on in Washington right now, and I was unavoidably delayed, but I could not have come in at a better time, as Andrea Mitchell, who has covered the State Department for a number of secretaries of state and through many different crises, was pointing out how much the work of the State Department and USAID depends upon the support of the Congress and the American public to do the work that we do in diplomacy and development. And this is an occasion that really highlights that. So thank you for joining us in celebrating the 60th anniversary of the 1951 convention related to the status of refugees. I am delighted to be joined here by the Undersecretary, Maria Otero, whose responsibilities include the work that Eric Schwartz, as our Assistant Secretary for refugees and many other things, carries out on a daily basis. I've had the opportunity to work with both Maria and Eric in the past, and I am just delighted that they are at the forefront of our efforts. And also to Alex Alenkakoff, the Deputy High Commissioner of the Office of the UN Commissioner for Refugees, thank you for being here. And of course, you've already heard about our distinguished honoree, Larry Hollingworth. I want to personally congratulate the honorees and their families, and particularly to add my voice to the words that have already been said about each of you. Each of the honorees was born in a different time and a different place, yet each also came to understand that if he or she failed to help, others would suffer and even die. And without fanfare and without ever expecting they would get an honor at the State Department in the year 2011, they stepped up and did what needed to be done. Like Captain Mbai Jain, who lost his life while rescuing strangers from genocide. He was a Senegalese army officer deployed to Rwanda as a UN military observer. The peacekeepers, as we well remember, had been ordered not to protect civilians, but when the killing began, he could not stand by. He took people out of harm's way. He saved 600 lives before he was killed by a stray mortar shell. Captain Jain's family joins us from our embassy in Dakar, Senegal. And I would particularly like to welcome his widow, Yassine Marjop, his mother, Fatou Endor, and his two children. Let us give another round of applause to this very brave man and the family that represents him. Today also tragically marks the date that the genocide began in Rwanda 17 years ago. So on this day of remembrance, we turn to Kigali, Rwanda, where our second honoree, Josephine Dusabi Mana, joins us via video link. And Josephine, we thank you. We thank you for being there with us. Because when the killing began and terrified people began showing up at your door, you did not just take them in. You hid them in your bedroom. You found canoes for them to escape across a lake to the Congo. You saved 5 people in this way. Later, you took in a mother and a baby. But when soldiers burst into the house, they killed them right before your eyes. Even so, a few weeks later, Josephine once again rescued a child in harm's way. Heroes such as Josephine have inspired Rwandans to build a different kind of society today. And Josephine, I salute and thank you for your example of such great courage and reconciliation. Whenever we have an event like this at the State Department honoring people of such courage, I think it's fair to say many of us wonder, what would we have done? Would we have been there for those who were being hunted down, who were in harm's way? Would we have reached out to help? Because in times of war and catastrophe, some people lose their moral bearings. But others find inside themselves a compass that steers a true course through fear and chaos. Larry Hollingworth is one of those people. And Larry, I understand you traveled from England to be with us today, and we thank you for being here so we can honor you in person. In 1994, Larry headed the Sarajevo office of the United Nations High Commissioner on Refugees. His job was to negotiate humanitarian access to besieged towns. He led convoys of food trucks through combat lines and evacuated hundreds of women and children to safety. And he warned the world about the dangers of Srebrenica months before those massacres happened. Those who serve in war zones discover the hard realities of trying to deliver aid, extricate refugees, negotiate ceasefires, and protect civilians. Larry Hollingworth brought courage, political acumen, and moral clarity to a seemingly impossible situation. And we need more public servants like you, Larry. Thank you so much. Finally, I will turn to our embassy in Sarajevo, where I see our ambassador, and where we are joined by Mina Zahic. Mina is Bosnian, and one day in 1994, she began to hear gunshots in the distance of people being executed. A bloody man stumbled out of the woods. He had been horribly beaten, but had managed to escape. Mina's neighbor turned the man away in fear. But Mina took him in and nursed him back to health. Over time, the neighbors were so inspired by Mina's courage that they too helped him. Mina's own son was executed, but the man she rescued, Farid Spahic, lived, and he is there with Mina in Sarajevo today. Mina, we thank you, and we express great appreciation for the life you saved and for the lives of all those who were saved by people who had the courage that you showed. Thank you so much. Now, all of these courageous people have one thing in common. They did not view people in trouble as strangers, as the other. They viewed them as fellow human beings. And they were unable to stand by and let brutality and violence and atrocities unfold. Today, we reaffirm America's commitment to the protection of refugees around the world. Our mission is unchanging. We intend to save lives and restore human dignity. But we could not do it just through the programs we run and through the excellent leadership we provide, and even in cooperation with the UN and many other international organizations. It takes individuals who day after day stand up and speak out, and more importantly, act on behalf of those who are in jeopardy. So we salute the courage and the dedication of all those whose moral compasses did not fail them, but instead compelled them to help in this vital endeavor of standing up for the very best values that unite all of us, regardless of geography or race, tribe or religion. There is a fundamental base of universal human rights, and we are each called to recognize and protect those, and some of us are asked to do so much more. So thank you. Thank you for joining us on this 60th anniversary. Take care. God bless you.
Our thanks to Secretary Clinton for having taken the time to recognize the importance of this event in the middle of everything else that she is doing and acknowledging the contributions of our heroes. Our thanks very much to their excellencies, the ambassador from Senegal, Ambassador Dine, Ambassador Kimonyo from Rwanda. Thank you so much for joining us. Our thanks to Assistant Secretary Schwartz and to the hero, Mr. Hollingsworth, who came so far to acknowledge what you helped to prevent the worst of the atrocities. And to all of our colleagues here today, please enjoy the Ben Franklin Rooms. Take a look at the photographs in the entryway. And thank you all for helping us salute the importance of this 60th anniversary of this most important convention. We've heard, going back to what Eric Schwartz said, the components of heroism, courage, integrity, humanitarianism, and what Secretary Clinton said, which is, would any of us have the courage to stand up and be counted if so challenged? And that's a question I guess we have to ask ourselves every day of our lives. Thank you all so much.